He created the universe. To him belong the heavens and the earth. The ever-living, he is the first. He's the owner and receiver. He sent his messengers to warn his creatures. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا إنه من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد my dear brothers and sisters in Islam today we are starting chapter number 2 of Kitab At-Tawheed and the title reads like this the superiority of Tawheed and what it removes of sins so The author, rahimahullah ta'ala, is going to talk about the merit of the Tawheed. What is the superiority of the Tawheed? And what does it do? Indeed, the Tawheed removes the sins, washes them away. So this is the title, and as we knew now, we mentioned previously that the author, he formulates the title, then he produces the relevant proofs to support that title. So now the title talks about the importance of the Tawheed and the benefit that you are going to reap. He quoted what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High and Exalted said, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ It is those who believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and confuse not their belief with dhulm. And dhulm here means shirk. For them only there is security and they are guided ones. This is in Surah 6, Ayah 82. So this is the ayah that the author is using as evidence and proof for the chapter. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Those who believed وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ And they didn't mix their iman with the dhulm. They did not pollute their iman and contaminate their iman by the dhulm. Dhulm means injustice, wrongdoing. And there are various types of dhulm. The highest Dhulm is the shirk. The highest injustice one can do to himself is to commit shirk and to associate partner with Allah. Are you following? There are also other types of dhulm like we wrong ourselves. You wrong yourself by disobeying Allah. When you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is dhulm against your own nafs, against your own self. Why? Because you are bringing upon yourself Allah's anger. You make Allah angry. And by disobeying Allah, if Allah didn't forgive you and envelop you and encompass you in His mercy, you will be ending in Jahannam, wal-iyadu billah. And that is indeed injustice you have done to yourself. Are you following? As a matter of fact, a man is an enemy against himself. If you love yourself, what should you choose for yourself? The good or the bad? If you like yourself, the good. Because you want to go to Jannah. You want to go to paradise. You want to have an everlasting life. Because when you commit sins and you follow your own desires, actually you don't like your nafs. And this shows the naivety of man and the stupidity of man. Are you following? So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he said alladhina amanu, those who believed and mixed not their iman with zulm, and confused not their iman with the zulm. The sahaba, they understood the zulm here in its broad sense. So they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they sat on their knees. And they said, oh Prophet of Allah, this ayah is so difficult for us. It's so heavy. Who can say I have never wronged myself? Any one of us? No one can say. And the ayah says, only those who did not wrong themselves, they will have that security on the day of resurrection. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنِ. So the amn and the security on the day of resurrection will be only granted to those who did not wrong themselves, who did not confuse their iman with injustice or zulm. Are you following? So the sahaba understood the zulm in its generic form. So here the Prophet ﷺ has to explain to them that the zulm in this context, it doesn't mean that wronging yourself. The zulm here, it means shirk. And that's why you need the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ to explain to you the Quran. Are you following? You cannot say, I know Arabic, the Sahaba, the new Arabic. And you cannot know the Arabic tongue more than the Sahaba. And yet, they understood the ayah in a different way. So the Prophet ﷺ had to explain to them that here the zulm, it is referring to the shirk. And that's why he told them, no, not as you understood. The zulm here is just like the zulm when Luqman said to his son, Ya Bunayya, O my son, La tushrik billah, do not associate any partner with Allah. Inna shirka, most certainly the shirk, la zulmun azim, great zulm, great injustice. So the zulm here, it means shirk. Are you following? So zulm here, it means the shirk. So now, the ayah is very relevant to the chapter, right? Because it says, those who did not confuse their iman with the zulm, with injustice, they will have security, aman, on the day of resurrection. There is security and they are guided ones on the day of resurrection. So this shows the virtue and the merit of the tawheed. Because in that day, the people, everyone is afraid, but you will be giving this security. You'll have this aman, this self-composure, this calmness, and you will be guided. This shows the merit of the tawheed. Are you following? Because the author, when he quotes an ayah, because the meaning in the ayah, sometimes you need to drill down to find and reflect and ponder. Sometimes, apparently, you might say, what is the relevance between the title and the ayah? But if you think, you see it is very relevant. Are you following? So now we know that if you commit shirk, you are not going to have the security on the day of resurrection. No security for those who commit shirk. So the security on that day, only for those who died upon the tawheed. Those who did not associate any partner with Allah. Are you following? If you die upon the shirk, you mixed up, you polluted your iman, you contaminated your iman, so Allah will not accept it. Is this clear? My dear brothers and sisters and dear viewers, stay tuned. We'll be back inshallah after the break. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, my dear brothers and sisters and dear viewers. So now we know that if you commit shirk, you are not going to have the security on the day of resurrection. No security for those who commit shirk. So the security on that day, only for those who died upon the tawheed. Those who did not associate any partner with Allah. Are you following? If you die upon the shirk, you mixed up, you polluted your iman, you contaminated your iman. So Allah will not accept it. Is this clear? Then the author, rahimahullah, mentioned something else, the hadith. This is the beauty about this book. Allah said, the Prophet said, that's it. Nothing more. Allah said this, the Prophet ﷺ said that. He quoted the hadith, which is sahih, narrated Ubadah ibn Samit, radiallahu anhu, that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من شهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله وأن عيسى عبد الله ورسوله وكلمته ألقاها إلى مريم وروح منه والجنة حق والنار حق أدخله الله الجنة على ما كان من العمل. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whoever testifies that there is nothing worthy of worship in truth except Allah alone, who is without peer or partner, and that Muhammad is his slave and messenger, and that Isa, Jesus Christ, is the slave of Allah, servant of Allah, his messenger, and his word, and his word that which he bestowed to in Maryam, and a spirit from him, and that paradise and hellfire are realities, Allah will admit him into paradise, whatever his deen might be. This is in Sahih Imam Bukhari. Now, the Prophet ﷺ is saying in this beautiful hadith, whoever testifies, man shahida, testifies. When you testify, you should know what you are testifying about, right? That's why, first of all, you should know what is the meaning of kalima. Some Muslim, if you ask him, what is the meaning of la ilaha illallah, he tells you, there is no God but Allah. Is this correct? There is no God but Allah. It's not the meaning that there is no God but God. Because there are many gods people worship, true or not? People, they have many false gods, right? They worship. So the true meaning of the kalima, la ilaha illallah, there is no true God or deity deserves or worthy of worship except Allah. That's the meaning of it. So the true God that you should worship and deserves to be worshipped is Allah only. Though there are many gods, small g, there are many objects worshipped, there are many deities worshipped. Are you following? People are worshipping idols, trees, many things, and say, this is my God, right? But who's the true God? Only one, and that's Allah. So the meaning of the kalima, la ilaha illallah, la ma'buda bihaq, illallah. There is no true deity, there is no deity that deserves to be worshipped except Allah. This is the key word. Because I want you to understand one thing. The kalima itself, la ilaha illallah, two parts. La ilaha, there is no God. This is negation. This is what? Negation. You negate. Illallah, affirmation. So first of all, you negate, then you affirm. Which comes first? Negation. What does it mean? When I say there is no God, is this belief or disbelief? There is no God. Is it belief or disbelief? Disbelief. There is no God. Yes. So first of all, you have to disbelieve. Then you have to believe. Disbelieve in what? You disbelieve in anything that is worshipped. All the things that people are worshipped should be under your foot. You disbelieve in them. You have to disbelieve in anything that is worshipped besides Allah. And that is the meaning of taghut. You understand? You have to disbelieve in the taghut. So first of all, you disbelieve, then you believe. You disbelieve in all the false deities, then you believe in Allah. And that was the Tawheed comes to the picture. The Tawheed can be only actualized, and you can only become Wahid if you negate and you affirm. Without negating affirmation itself, that will not make you a monotheist or a Muwahid. Are you following? For example, we'll take an example to explain this. I say, John is a clever student, bright student. Does this make John the only one who is bright or clever? Or maybe the another one is clever also? Is he unique? Tell me. No. Now, if I say John or Ali or Muhammad or any other name, the same thing, he's brilliant, this will not make him unique. If I say now, John is thick, okay? He's not smart. Does this mean he's the only student who's not smart? See, in the first example, I say, John is a clever boy. This is what? Negative or positive statement? Positive statement. Now I'm saying he's not, I'm negating it. So in both cases, he's not unique, right? But if I say there is no brilliant students or smart students in this class except John, he becomes what? Unique. So the uniqueness or the singularity comes into being if there is a negation and affirmation. Are you following? So in the presence of the negation and the affirmation, the uniqueness or singularity takes place. Is this clear? So that's why in the kalima, there is negation and affirmation, which means Allah unique. And that's why he's the only one that deserves the ibadah. Is this clear to everyone? Are you following? So that's why when you say, La ilaha illallah, first of all, you negate, then you affirm. You disbelieve in anything that is worshipped besides Allah, and you believe in Allah and Allah only. And therefore, that reason, the non-Muslims, the pagans, the idol worshippers at the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not say the kalima because they knew the meaning of it. Are you following? They knew the meaning of it. If I say la ilaha illallah, that this means I should not worship idols. Because the idol, does it deserve the worship? And regarding this meaning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْحَقِّ Allah is the true, is the absolute truth, الحق. وَأَنَّمَا يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِهِ And whatever they call besides him, هُوَ الْبَاطِلِ It is batil, it is falsehood. Are you following? So now what's the meaning of la ilaha illallah? There is no deity worthy of worship but Allah. So it's not meaning there is no God but God. Are you following? Because when you say there is no God but God, that means, first of all, in reality there are many gods, people they worship. Number two, also there is a hidden meaning, very dangerous meaning. When you say there is no God but God, that means anything you worship is God. Are you following? Because when I say there is no God but God, that means anything you worship is God. And in that case, you become a pantheist. Are you following, brothers? So, but when you say there is no deity worthy of worship but Allah, you single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, "Man shahida, whoever testifies, Alla ilaha illallah." Now we know the meaning of la ilaha illallah. No deity deserves to be worshipped. There is no God worthy of worship but Allah. Wahdahu la sharika lah, he has no partners. Wa anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. That Muhammad is his servant, his slave, and messenger. Some people, when they hear the word slave, it gives them, because the connotation, this word is associated with the slavery we know. They feel it's not a good word to be used. But in reality, the true freedom is only when you become a slave for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if you don't want to become a slave of Allah, you will be a slave of many things. Do you think you are free if you are not worshipping Allah? No, you are a slave. You are a slave for your own desires. You are a slave for the money. You are a slave for Fame. Fame is your god. You want to become a star, okay? So you are a slave. The model is a slave. She cannot do whatever she wants. If she wants to eat her mother's dish, favorite dish, she cannot eat it because she will put in weight. So they are telling her, no, you have to maintain your figure. You are a slave. You listen to what they are saying. The footballer. Don't you read a newspaper? Team so-and-so, player so-and-so, buying and selling? What is that? That is slavery. So if you want to become a free, real free man, worship Allah and Allah only. Otherwise, you will be a slave, and a slave for many things. That's why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَيْلٌ تَعْسَ عَبْدُ الدِّينَارِ تَعْسَ عَبْدُ الْقَطِيفَ وَالْخَمِيسِ. Woe to him, the worship of the dirham and the worship of the dinar. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us that you say Abdullah wa Rasuluh. And this is very crucial, very important. You describe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as Rasulullah and at the same time as his servant. These two words, they prevent us from going to the extreme. They stop us from going to a extreme. By saying he's Rasulullah, I have to say, whenever he tells me something, I hear and I obey. Because he is Rasulullah, so whatever he tells me, I accept it. Because he is Rasulullah. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, when Abu Jahl told him, have you heard what your friend has told us today? He said, no. Because Sayyidina Abu Bakr was not present. He said, what did he tell you? He said, he told us he went last night to Jerusalem and came back. Sayyidina Abu Bakr said, did he say so? He said, yes. He said, he told you the truth. Sayyidina Abu Bakr had no problem because he is Rasulullah. Once you accept him as Rasulullah, whatever he says, you accept. Not like us today, many Muslims. You tell him the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this. Why? Why? I'm not convinced. What? You're not convinced? Do you know the meaning of this word? Do you know what does that mean? This can take you out of Islam. Because this contradicts your shahada, your testimony, when you say he's Rasulullah. How you say he's Rasulullah, and he tells you now, and you say, I will not accept. My dear brothers and sisters and dear viewers, wherever you are, when you read the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, imagine yourself standing in front of him. Will you ever dare to say, I will not accept what you are saying? You will never dare to such things. So what's the difference? Because he's not present, his sunnah is with us. So whenever you read the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, imagine yourself, you are in front of him and he is commanding you. And this is the meaning of Muhammad Rasulullah. You have accepted him as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. My dear brothers and sisters, inshallah, we'll be continuing chapter number 2 in the coming episode. Looking forward for that.
He created the universe. To him belong the heavens and the earth. The ever-living, he is the first. He's the owner of mercy. He sent his messengers to warn his creatures of the grave dangers of worshiping other than Allah.
Because you're terrified.